singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. Before I took a breath, you breathed your life in me. So, so kind to me. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
You won't.
God's thoughts toward us are higher than our thoughts toward us sometimes. We tend to go in one of two different ways. We'll tend to either think too highly of ourselves, or we'll tend to berate ourselves. But the Lord, through His work, through the Son, the perfect Son and the sacrifice, has made us holy and perfect before God. And what really matters is what He thinks of us. Amen. And so when He calls us to do things, as He will, because we are to be about our Father's business as well, sometimes He'll ask us to do things that are more difficult than we think we can handle. But He who calls will also provide, and He will empower those that He uses for His purpose. And that's all of us in some way. Amen.
I think it was the first song that we sang this morning, where you mentioned God pursuing us, and the line was just kept sticking out to me as we sang it over and over again, that He will, there's no lie that He won't tear down. I don't think I quoted that correctly, but
close enough,
but you get what I mean. There's no lie that He won't tear down. In His pursuit of us, God wants us to know the truth. And I'm so thankful for His Word, because His Word is truth. And He gives that to us, and He wants us to understand it. And the Holy Spirit takes God's Word, and He helps us to understand it. And so, one of the things that hit me some years ago is that when I understand something, a spiritual truth, when I understand God's Word, that is a work of God, and He wants me to act upon that. Because in and of myself, I cannot understand it. And you know what that's like when you read God's Word, and maybe as you are on your journey trying to understand God at some time in the past, and you open that Bible and it just did not make sense to you, and then one day it did. That's a work of God. And I just love that line where he tears down the lie. And that's especially appropriate this morning in Colossians, because in Paul's letter, as you know, as he wrote this, he was in prison. And as he wrote this letter, there was a problem in this area, identified, the city identified by Colossae by the name of the book that's given to it, the name of the letter. Now, Paul had never been there, by every indication. He said a couple of things in the letter that let us know that. And even in his journey in the book of Acts, it did not take him into that region. And so the church was likely started by someone else. That it was under Paul's ministry. And so the church was started, but Paul got word while he was in prison that there was a problem there. There were lies that were there. And we have to always be on our guard that there is always an attempt to separate Christ and the church. There's always an attempt to separate Christ and the church. Now that can happen in a couple of different ways. One of those ways is by leading us down the wrong path in the way that we live. Because when we begin to act opposite, contrary to the Scriptures in our day-to-day walk, then in the eyes of those who watch, and even in our own eyes, in the eyes of our families, Christ is somehow separated from the church. But there's a second way, and that is this, is that if our understanding of who Jesus Christ is perverted in some way, it's altered in some way other than what is revealed in the Scripture, then in that way, Christ is separated from the church. Now, you and I know that salvation and the relationship between Jesus and the church is eternal. There's nothing that can that will break that bond. But when I say separate, what I mean is that the perception by the rest of the world, if the church falls into sort of a dull sleep and drifts away from the truth of who Jesus Christ is, there is a separation that occurs, not eternally, but we see it even in the book of Revelation. When you look at that list of churches that John, that Jesus gave to John in that revelation, the messages that he gave to those churches, to a couple of them, were very abrupt, I'll say, because they had drifted away from Jesus. They had walked away. And so I want us to look at this passage here in Colossians this morning and to see that as this church in Colossae is facing this error that is there. See, the gospel came down into the midst of a culture where the belief system about how to get to God and who God was it was really a mess. If we tried to describe it, you can go read about it during this period of time, but if you try to describe it, you just kind of shake your head and say, I don't understand that. And so the message of who Jesus was came down into this culture into this kind of teaching. And Paul was intent that Jesus not, the understanding of who Jesus was, did not get caught up in that mess. He wanted that message of Christ to be a very distinctive message of the truth of who Jesus is. And so Paul, as he opens up this letter, if you look at verse 9 in chapter 1, he prays for them. And like Paul does so often, he prays and he says, we do not cease to pray for you in verse 9 and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. So Paul prays for wisdom and knowledge for them. Prays for knowledge. Now that's interesting that he would pray for that, because one of the errors that was in that in Colossae, in that vicinity, in that region, was there was an emphasis on knowledge. And the more knowledge you got, the closer you could get to God. And so you had to have this sort of a super spiritual knowledge experience that just not everybody got, you know. There was this sort of a hierarchy, and the more of that you got, the closer you could get to God. That was one of the teachings there. And so it's interesting that he prays for them that they would have knowledge of his will in all spiritual, or in all wisdom and spiritual understanding. So that's the indicator of what kind of knowledge it was wisdom and spiritual understanding kind of knowledge. And then he goes on and he says, for this reason, in other words, I want you to have this knowledge, pray for this cause, that you may walk worthy of the Lord. So in other words, I'm going to pray for knowledge for you so that you can walk with the Lord, worthy of him, fully pleasing him, being fruitful in every good work. What does it mean to walk worthy of the Lord? It means pleasing him and being fruitful in every good work. In other words, the act of service and the lifestyle is to please the Lord and to be a working servant of the Lord, being fruitful in every good work and increasing in the knowledge of God. I mean, you can see the kind of circular thing that's happening there. The more you God gives you the knowledge of his will, the more you walk worthy of him, you serve him, you please him, and he gives you more knowledge about him. In verse 11, he says here that we have some help in this process, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power. And he says, because we have to have that strength, because we can't do it in and of our own. It's already been mentioned this morning. And then to modify that just a bit, he says, for all patience and long suffering with joy. In other words, our attitude, our disposition in all of this is that we do it with patience and long suffering and joy. When you begin to think about this prayer and everything that I've just gone through and just barely skipped a stone across the pond there and just barely touched it, we learn how we ought to pray. There's certain things that I need to pray for, and they're right here in this passage of Scripture. But then he continues and he says, with joy giving thanks in verse 12 to the Father who has qualified us to be partakers of the inheritance of all the saints in the light. And then he says in verse 13, he gives an assurance in the midst of this prayer. He says, he has delivered us from the power of darkness and converted us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. So he gives us an assurance at the end of this, as he's praying here. He says, listen, it's all a done deal. Remember, he has delivered us. And he has transferred us from the power of darkness and conveyed us into the kingdom of the Son of his love. Have you ever been praying and then sometimes you might just break into a song? It might be that you're driving in the car and you're listening to something. Maybe you're listening to scripture play, or maybe you're listening to some preacher on the radio, some teacher on the radio, and something just hits you, and then all of a sudden you break into a song because it jogs in your memory some song, maybe from your youth, or maybe something you just learned, and you start singing. That's exactly what happens in the next verse. Paul is praying for them, and in verse 15, there is a song that is inserted here that Paul begins to tell these folks, to give to these people, because it is a song that reflects who Jesus is. And here's what he says. And this is the passage I want to focus on this morning in this time that we have. Verse 15, and this is where we'll be this morning. He is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn over all creation. He is Jesus. Okay? For by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones and dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. And he is before all things, and in him all things consist, and he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that in all things he may have the preeminence. Now that may not sound very much like a song to you, like we just sang, but it is. In fact, if you go back and look at the Psalms, the 150 that are just about in the middle of your scripture, when you look at those Psalms, they don't sound like songs like we would think of them, but they are lyrics, and they have a rhythm to them, and so does this. And Paul has put this here because in this time of error in the church that was threatening the church, Paul said, listen, the answer to the error is you need to know who Jesus is. You need to know who Jesus is. And so that's what I want us to look at this morning. Would you pray with me, please? Father, thank you for giving us your word. Thank you that you tear down the lies, that you do not leave us in the darkness of our ignorance, that you have pursued us, that you have tenaciously come after us. Some recognized your call early on, and some of us, it took many, many decades for that to happen. And some are in the midst of that right now, maybe even in this room, of trying to understand who you are. God, I pray that you'd make that clear to us, and that the more and more we know who you are, Lord, that we will respond to you in faith. Some in here for the first time, and some of us need to have our faith strengthened. God, I pray that you do that in these minutes, just now, in Jesus' name. Amen. So, Paul prays, and toward the end of his prayer, he breaks out into this song to identify who Jesus really is. And there are a couple of basic questions. I don't think we're going to get to all of them today. In this passage from verses 15 through 20, there are a couple of basic questions. And the first one is what is Jesus' relationship to his creation? That's the first question that's answered here. The second question that is answered here is, what is Jesus' relationship to the redemption of his creation? That's the second question, which we may not get to. So I don't know why I told you that, but you just needed to know that. So let's see who Jesus is here. Who is he? Well, it says he is the image of the invisible God. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. Now, there are a couple of meanings to this word image, and we have an image actually right there on that screen right now. There is an image of a Bible, right? We know that that is actually not a Bible. That's an image of a Bible. And so we have that understanding in our own modern definition of the word image, that the word image is like a picture or a representation. But that's not what he's talking about here, because there's another meaning for this word image, and it is actually that the image actually carries with it the presence of that image, the actual presence of the original. It's actually present in the image. I'm fascinated with the sun. I just love looking at the sun. It warms me. It accomplishes so much in this world. And sometimes we just, we go throughout our day and we take it for granted. But the sun fascinates me. It's so large, you could put a million of our Earths in that sun. It's one of over a billion stars that we know of. I think it's kind of considered a medium-sized star, nothing special. At its core, it's 28 million degrees Fahrenheit. I don't know how they measured that, but they did. It's a big thermometer. And it's under a lot of pressure, especially at its core. The sun is actually a big ball of hydrogen. And it's under so much pressure, it's something like 250 billion times our Earth's atmosphere, the pressure that's there. And it goes through this fusion process, and it actually takes that hydrogen and it converts it into helium. And in that process of converting it to helium, there are these photons that are created and down there at the core. And those light photons, they tell us that it takes tens of thousands, maybe up to 100,000 years for those light photons to get to the from the core of the sun to the out to the outer layer of the sun, so that it actually is the light that you and I actually see. But then as it comes out, it only takes, it may take 10,000, 100,000 years for those to get from the core of the sun to that hour later, but you know, it only takes about 8 minutes, a little over 8 minutes for that light to actually get here to the Earth. And when that light gets here, we have heat, there's radiation, there is light so that you and I can actually see each other right now. We have light, otherwise we'd be in the darkness. Now, here in Colossians, we see that it is Jesus who makes God known. He is the image of the invisible God. You and I have no idea what it actually looks like down there at the core of the sun. But when those photons come out and the light hits that outer atmosphere of the sun, or the outer layer of the sun, and you and I experience the heat and the light, the warmth, and the benefit that the light brings, we instantly know what the sun is. We know what it is because of that light. Jesus is the image of the invisible God. We know the properties of the interior of the sun because of the light and the heat that we can see and feel from it. And God has made himself known in Jesus Christ. He is an image. But he is an image that bears the very presence of God himself, as the light and the heat bear the very presence of the sun and what's going on in the interior of that sun. Jesus Christ bears the very presence of God himself. He's not just a picture image, not just a statue, not just a representative. He is God himself. Image does not mean symbol here. If you notice in Hebrews chapter 10, verse 1, I'm just going to read this quickly, but it says, I want you to notice here the definition of how the word image changes so that we get an understanding of this. He says, the writer of Hebrews says, for the law, having of the good things to come being a shadow and not the very image of the things. Can this shadow never with these same sacrifices which they offer continually year by year make those who approach perfect? In other words, the Old Testament sacrifices were a shadow. But he says they are not the very image of what was to come. See, the definition of image had changed even here in the New Testament. When Paul says image here in the book of Colossians, he means God is present. That's who Jesus Christ is. He is the image of the invisible God. So it's not just a symbol here that he speaks of. There is actually substance. In Hebrews chapter 1, 3 of Jesus, it says, who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person. Jesus is the exact representation of God because he is God. In John 1, it says, no one has seen God at any time. The only begotten Son who is in the bosom of the Father, he has declared him. It is Jesus who declares the very nature of God to us because he is God. It matters when we see Christ in the Bible that we understand that the God who was invisible is now visible. And I mean more than just physical sight. The Old Testament saints believed in God. Abraham had tremendous faith, but there was always this distance between the person and God, which is one thing, by the way, that makes Abraham's faith so amazing. But Jesus brought God near because he is God. So in the Old Testament, we are commanded to love, right? But in the New Testament, we see Jesus loving the leper. In the Old Testament, we are told to forgive. But in the New Testament, we see Jesus forgiving the woman at the well who had five husbands, and the one she was living with at the time was not her husband. We hear that God loves us in the Old Testament. He tells us that. But we see Jesus mourning over Jerusalem and weeping. We see Jesus weeping at the tomb of Lazarus, showing his love. There's something a bit more powerful in this word image too. We see back in the Old Testament in the commandments that they were not to make an image. God commanded the people, do not make any graven image. You shall not make a graven image of any likeness or anything that is in heaven above, or that is in the earth beneath, or that is in the water under the earth. No one was to make an image of God, because God did not want them to confine their understanding of him to a man-made copy. That copy would be imperfect. It would be in our image, really. It would not be in the image of God. A reproduction. No doppelgangers, if you will. It would be limited, and it would limit the maker's knowledge of God if they began to worship that image. God, all-present, all-knowing, all-powerful, holy, could not be confined to a statue. And so he says, do not make an image. Do not make an image. Man was created in God's image. And man has many of the attributes of God. He's a thinker, he reasons, he loves, he has a spirit. But he's imperfect, he's sinful because he's been tainted by sin. But we have love and reason, we create, we have emotion, we choose. But we've been corrupted. Jesus, however, is the very express image of God, the exact representation of who God is. Scripture says, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to what? To the image of his Son. Jesus is the image of the invisible God, and we are to be conformed to that very image. How could Jesus be anything less than God? In Colossians 3:10, it says, we have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge according to what? According to the image of the one that created him. This is a hymn about Jesus placed here to combat the lie, to tear down the lie that the church was experiencing at that moment. He was not just an emanation from God, he is God. He did not appear just to have a body, he actually was human, and he is right now as you and I sit here. He is the God-man. So my question is what do you believe about Jesus? What is your understanding of Jesus? Is Jesus just a picture of God? Or is he God himself? Well, Paul says the very presence of God is present when Jesus showed up. He is the image of God. But not only is he the image of God, but it also says he is the image of the, or he is the firstborn over all creation. Jesus is the firstborn over all creation. Jesus is over all creation. And yet he is the firstborn. So in the same way that we have to have our understanding of that word image and what that means, we need to have a biblical understanding of this idea of firstborn. The firstborn was a combination of words that meant to bring forth and to do it first. to bring forth and to do it first. And so there was these couple of different meanings. There was the first in birth order. Some of you have children and you know that your children, when you think firstborn, you already have an image in your mind of who that firstborn is, right? I do. And I have five children, and when someone says, who's your firstborn? I just did this the other day, and I'm getting to be more like an old person, because when people ask about my children, I want to pull the phone out and get the pictures out and say, this was my firstborn. He's in the army right now. I start telling them about it all. I know who my firstborn is. But that's not what he means here. He means first in preeminence, first in prominence. First in privilege, first in privilege, in order, in rank, was the firstborn. And there are a couple of places in the Bible where we see this meaning of this word firstborn. Even in the Old Testament, it's speaking about David here in Psalm 89:27. God says, I also will make him my firstborn, the highest of the kings of the earth. Now, David was not the first king. We know that Saul was. And we know that there were other kings in the world at that point. But as a king of Israel, David was not the first. And yet God says, I will make him my firstborn. So the definition of firstborn has been altered. In Exodus chapter 4, God tells Moses to say to Pharaoh, Israel is my firstborn. Israel was not the first nation in the world, and yet they were God's chosen, and so they had the firstborn privileges and honor. They were the firstborn because they were preeminent in God's eyes. But interesting, in Jeremiah chapter 31, he says, God says, for I am father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Now, if you know Ephraim, the name Ephraim, that became sort of interchangeable with the name Israel over time. But it's interesting that word Ephraim, if you remember when Jacob came back to Egypt, and Joseph was there, and we're getting now toward the end of the book of Genesis, when he's there, and Joseph is there, and there's this time of blessing, and there is this time of the assignment of properties, and all of that stuff's going on at the end. Joseph comes, and he brings his two children, and that's where we get the half-tribes. That's why if you look at a map of Israel, and you look at the tribes, you don't see Joseph's name anywhere. You see his two sons. And Joseph brings to Jacob, he brings these two boys, and he puts the older boy, Manasseh, on Jacob's right hand over here. And he puts Ephraim on Jacob's left hand. Why? Because the right hand was to receive that blessing of the firstborn. And so Joseph's blessing was going to be extended to his sons, and Jacob does something in the middle of that. He says, no, 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 and he crosses his hands, and Joseph says, wait a minute. He said, you got this wrong. My firstborn is Manasseh. Jacob says, listen, I know what I'm doing, and he blesses Ephraim, and he makes Ephraim the firstborn. Not because he was born first, because he was first in priority. And now here in Jeremiah 31, God says, for I am father to Israel, and Ephraim is my firstborn. Now you take all of that and you wrap it all up, all that information about what the idea of firstborn is, and you go back now to Colossians, and you see where he says, in verse 15, he is the image of the invisible God. He is the firstborn of all creation. He's not saying here that Jesus was born or Jesus was created. What he is saying is that Jesus is preeminent over all of creation. Our understanding of who Jesus is so important. Now, I know that in your walk, in your journey with the Lord, you may have been saved at an early age, but or sometime in the past, and as you learned more about Jesus, it began to bring up questions to you. You said, "Did I really get saved? Did I need to know that in order to be saved?" I don't know if you've ever thought that way, but I have. Maybe I missed something along the way. And the question is what are you doing with that information? What are you doing with that knowledge? What do you do with that revelation or that illumination from God when God shows you this? Do you reject it or do you receive it? That's the determination of your salvation. The firstborn. Jesus is the preeminent one. You may have never thought of him like that. But here, at the beginning of this hymn, the two things that Paul says is that he is the very presence of God because he is God, and he is the preeminent one over all creation. You need to understand that. And in a context of lies, in an atmosphere of untruth about how to get to God, Paul says, I need to identify to you the person of Jesus Christ. And by the way, if you look at any of those other religions out there, if they ever come and knock on your door, if you ever meet one on the street, if in your witnessing and your evangelism, you ever come across this, the ultimate question that defines them, that will identify them immediately, is who do you say that Jesus Christ is? Because that question will solve a lot of other really unimportant questions. It will eliminate them. And Paul says here to the Colossians, let me identify to you who Jesus is. He is God. And he is over everything. What a wonderful hymn this really is. What do you believe about Jesus? In Hebrews chapter 1, verse 6, it says, but when he again brings the firstborn in the world, he says, let all the angels of God worship him. No mere man, no mere image would be worshiped by the angels. In Romans 8:29, it says, for whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his son, that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. This passage in Colossians is not intended to make him a part of creation. This passage is designed to totally separate Jesus from his creation. He is the first. He has the privilege. He is of the highest rank. It does not mean first created, it means firstborn in the sense of those ways that we've already spoken about it. I don't have much time left. I've only gotten through two words. Let's keep going just a little bit. It says in verse 16, for by him all things were created that are in heaven and that are on earth, visible and invisible, whether thrones or dominions or principalities or powers, all things were created through him and for him. Someone once said that about 90% of all of our theology is tied up in the prepositions in the Bible. And you see that here. I don't know if that's true or not, but it sounded pretty good, so I thought I'd say it. It says in the first line of verse 16, for by him were all things created. And then in the last line, through him and for him were all things created. By him and through him and for him were all things created. Now it's interesting, this word by that he uses here, it's actually the word in. At the core of this word is the word in. And what it means is that all of creation was under Jesus' influence. It was in the sphere of his rule and authority and preeminence was all of creation. I just put a countertop in my kitchen and I did a backsplash too. And it really looked really good there for a little while. But what I noticed is I ripped all of this out and tried to put the new stuff back in there was that there wasn't a 90 degree angle in that kitchen. I don't think there's one in the house. And nothing is square. It's an older house. But what I realized was, is that what I had been looking at all of those years that we had lived there was that whoever did that had to use a lot of plaster and shims and all kinds of stuff to make that thing come out to where everything, by the time it hit the molding around the door frames, that it looked like it was okay. But I had to use, when I took my big square and I took my tape measure and I took my level and tried to make everything right, it was almost impossible. And the way, the only way to do it would be to tear the whole building down and go right back down to the foundation and start over and build it back upright. And so I had to use some shims and some other stuff to put everything in there. And I ended up using some the cement that you put the backsplash up with. I had to do all of that and kind of taper it in to make everything look right so that it would hit the door jamb correctly. Jesus, when this world was created, Scripture says it was created by Him or in Him. Every detail of creation was under His supervision. And not only was He directing it and planning it and bringing it to pass, but Jesus was the square, He was the ruler, He was the level by which all of this world and all of this universe and all of the, even the invisible powers that have ever been created were created. The Scripture tells us that Jesus is the cornerstone, right? He is the chief cornerstone. The cornerstone back then, you know what this was. It was the stone that they would lay down that was perfectly square at the corner of whatever building they were making. And every other measurement came off of that. It was every measurement and every angle was determined by that one stone, the very beginning. Jesus. It says all things were created in Him. In Him. This creation, this universe, when it gets dark out here and the clouds go away, look up there tonight. All of that, bam, He created it by His word. And it was all perfect because it was measured out, it was planned, it was put in order by Him. And then if you move down, it says all things were created through Him as well, down toward the bottom of that verse in verse 16. All things were created through Him. That means that He is the very means of creation. It was by His word that it was all created. And then it tells us that they were all created for Him. That word "for" is actually the word "to" or "into," and it gives direction and purpose. You ever thought about that for just a moment? That the very reason for creation is Jesus? It says, all things were created unto Him. "For" doesn't really give us the complete picture. Into Him, unto Him, to Him. Are you wondering what your purpose in life is? See, this isn't just a hymn about Jesus. It's a hymn about you and what He created. You're wondering whether there's a reason to keep going. Why am I at this job where it's kind of a monotonous, undefined job where it doesn't seem like I make any difference in this world? Why am I there right now? I don't know why you're there, but I know this. You were created for the purpose of Jesus Christ, unto Him. And there is a reason for you to be there. Now, He may move you at some time. Why do I have this disease? Why do I hurt? Why has my family fallen apart? I can't give you answers to all those questions, but the one question that I can't answer is that you were created for the purpose of Jesus Christ. And if that doesn't give you a reason to look ahead, to look up, to look forward, to have hope, to find your satisfaction for life in Him. He values us. All things were created unto Him. I'm out of time. I don't know where this leaves you with this understanding of who Jesus Christ is. But it demands a response from you. Because God doesn't give knowledge for no reason. If you have any understanding, if you looked at that and you said, wow, I didn't know that, but there's something that rings very true about this. That means He wants you to respond in some way today. Don't put it off today. It may be that you're not a Christian and you're on a journey. You've been searching. You've been trying to have some questions answered. Maybe this was another step today for you of the identity of Jesus Christ. Because not only did He create the world, not only is He God, but it means much more when you understand the cross and what He did to come here to save your soul, to redeem you from sin, from destruction, from death, and to make you a new creation in Christ. That's what He did. So I would ask you today, if you've not yet made that decision in your life, would you do what God wants you to do today? Respond to Him. Respond to this knowledge. Throw yourself at His mercy today and tell Him, Lord, I believe. I believe that You did this for me. I believe that You were raised from the dead. I believe that You will save me because You created me and You redeemed me. And I want to be with You. It may be that you're a Christian and you haven't been walking with God. You've gotten away from Him. Maybe you've gotten away and nobody else knows it but you. Well, God knows. And you come here week after week and you go through the motions. And you know all the right things to say. Now, let me encourage you today. Confess your sins to Him. Repent. Turn back to Him. Because He's God. Because He's the only one. He's the firstborn. He's the preeminent one. He knows you. And because He created you as well. And He wants you to walk with Him, to be with Him, and to experience the joy of your salvation. Pray with me, please. Father, I thank You for this word of who Jesus is today. God, we need to be reminded of this moment by moment, day by day, minute by minute, that we're not just here wandering in this earth aimlessly, but that You have a reason for all that You did. Thank You, Lord, for saving us. Thank You for calling us back. God, I pray You'd give the freedom to those hearts today here that need to respond to You in some way. In Jesus' name, amen. We're going to have just a time of invitation for you to let God deal with your heart. If you need to pray about something, I'll be here at the front. I'd love to pray with you. Chip? Deep, my faith will stand.
grace abounds in deepest waters. Your sovereign hand will be my guide. Where feet may fail and fear surrounds me, you've never failed and you won't start now. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul rests in your embrace, for I am yours. My soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours, and you are mine. Justice without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander, and my faith will be made stronger in the presence of my Savior. Spirit, lead me where my trust is without borders. Let me walk upon the waters wherever you would call me, and take me deeper than my feet could ever wander. Let my faith become made stronger in the presence of my Savior. And I will call upon your name and keep my eyes above the waves. When oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace, for I am yours. I will call upon your name. my soul.